Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Youth Matters. Now, Youth Matters looks at local, national and global issues affecting the youth today. And today we're discussing a very, very important topic that doesn't always get the attention it deserves, yet has a catastrophic effect if we choose not to look into it and deal with the issues surrounding it. Now, today we are looking at the issue of climate change and what causes it, what we can do, and what kind of things we need to be aware of so we're tackling it on a day-to-day basis. It is predicted by 2030 and 2050 that climate change will take over 250,000 additional lives. Now, that is horrifying. That is really scary to even think about, to comprehend. But this is the reality of climate change. And the worry is whether or not we know enough about it and whether we're doing enough about it. As Komra show climate change lo yamra o discussion khora. A climate change lo lahta khta kana dekhoin zen weather beshi goromo izai beshi mego ayo ar akhta khta dunya maze sob deshain tor maze shoman nai weather. So ikta khen e So amra nani okta loya amra asko discussion kormo ar amra sai afnara o involve hoyta afnara amra rakhoka ikta khen ne hoy amra kita kortam parmo ar afnara kita khorra afnara community er maze ikta tik korbar dai as always this is a show for you and we want you to get involved we want you to tell us what you think about climate change if you're studying climate change in science for example what have you learnt and what are your views on the things that our guests are sharing with us today so please do get involved the numbers on the screen as should the email address so please get involved let us know what you think I'll start off with you Manadia some people watching at home will be thinking what is climate change yeah. they might be familiar with the term but yeah. they might not necessarily understand what it entails so if you want to start off by telling us what it means
so essentially what climate change is global warming. So people think they're two different things, but one is related to the other. What happens is you burn fossil fuels, where we get most of our energy from, and what it does is it releases gases which trap heat in our atmosphere, and it warms up the atmosphere. Now, it's all scientific, but the thing is there's an actual implication on the world and the people that live on the planet.
Okay, so in terms of difference, so we're looking at, obviously, Latifa, we're looking at climate change, but we're understanding that it's also got a link to global warming as well. Now, why is it that we hear more about global warming and we don't hear about climate change? Well, why is that used more often?
Well, I think climate change really kind of refers to how, you know, the heat that is trapped in the Earth's atmosphere is leading ultimately to the severe weather conditions that we're seeing. So, for example, it's just been recorded that this year has been the hottest year ever recorded on Earth. So I think this is why Wow. people tend to use the term global warming, but that's a slightly misleading too, because actually we're seeing in certain parts of the world, because they, you know, in the Antarctic, ice is melting faster than ever before. In other places, you know, we are getting extreme flooding, while some places are having severe, you know, winters. So, for example, in the United States, for example, we're getting really severe, you know, snowstorms. So I think this is really why some people don't understand climate change as well as the term global warming.
Okay, thank you. Kusum, people often assume that climate change is all about things that affect the environment and polar bears. Surely that can't be just about it.
No, of course not. Yeah, no. So climate change is something that's going to affect all of us, every single one of us in every country around the world and generations to come. That's why it's such an important subject that needs to be like spread awareness around, and everyone needs to recognize that it's not just something that, you know, some hippies are concentrating on for their own reasons. It's something that our children and our children's children are going to see the direct effects. For us at the moment, okay, we might just like slide past it for the next maybe 20, 30 years, but the effects are going to be drastic and our children will be seeing them.
Sure. Now, Manadia, do you feel that enough is being done to raise awareness about this topic?
Well, I mean, that's an interesting question, because if enough was being done, we wouldn't be in the position that we are in right now. The thing is, like you said, climate change is seen as like a faraway concept. It's a polar bear concept. The issue is that it's not. It's a current concept that is affecting people within the UK, people across the world, and if we were doing enough about it, this wouldn't be happening. The thing is, a lot of us, our countries, the UK specifically and the USA, are using a lot of fossil fuels, and the people that are being affected by it are third world countries like Bangladesh and sure. Pakistan, through flooding, through other natural disasters.
Okay.
And so what's happening is that the Earth is trying to overcome the issues that it's facing through natural disasters. So in fact, when climate change is occurring, it's affecting us. So when we're trying to tackle climate change, it's not something that we're doing for the world, it's something that we're doing for ourselves. And so in fact, it's a bit of a selfish concept.
Okay. Now, Latifa, you know, Munadi has spoken about how relevant it is to us. But why do you think, why is it that we don't talk about it enough? Surely this is directly impacting all of us.
Yeah, so okay. I think because, as Munadia says, we're living in the developed world, we all enjoy our luxuries, and essentially that's the reason why people probably shy away from talking about climate change, because it does lead back to the question, are we, as people who are living in the developed world, is what we're doing actually causing so much more suffering and, you know, the vulnerable lives in places like Bangladesh to suffer further? And that's actually true, because I've seen myself firsthand the disasters of climate change leading to some people not being able to grow their own foods, for example, not being able to grow their own crops, not actually having access to clean water. And those are the ramifications. And just because we live in the developed world and we have access to clean water, you know, we're almost turning a blind eye. And also, I think that, as you know, as a young Muslim myself, you know, I'm passionate about us thinking about Islam's teachings on, you know, looking after the earth and the environment.
Sure.
And we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam already said, you know, he put us as custodians on this earth. So it's actually a personal responsibility for us, and an issue of justice.
Sure. We're going to watch a video in a moment to do with climate change. But before, I'm still staying with you. It's interesting what you say, because a lot of our audience watching, you know, are from, you know, have Bangladesh heritage, and, you know, they love and they care for their relatives back home, their family back home. But what you're saying is our actions could be hurting the very people that we love and we care for and we send money to back in Bangladesh.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what we need to recognise as a community here. And a lot of it does go back to education. As I say, I think sometimes it's not helpful to use the term climate change. We should just talk about the fact that we're living in times where our actions are now affecting people halfway across the world. And really, that's what it's about. It's about us not, you know, throwing away. We're a throwaway society, basically. We throw away plastic when actually we could recycle that.
Okay.
You know, we're wasting more, and that is ultimately leading to the a deficit for people who are poorer than us around the world.
Okay, we're going to watch a short video on climate change, and then we'll come back and carry on with the discussion.
There was once a land where the weather was very, very strange. There were awful heat waves in some parts, and in others, terrible storms and floods. Scientists said it was being caused by too much CO2, which went up into the sky when the grown-ups used energy. They said the CO2 was getting dangerous. Its effects were happening faster than they had thought. Some places could even disappear under the sea, and it was the children of the land who'd have to live with the horrible consequences. The grown-ups realized they had to do something. They discovered that over 40% of the CO2 was coming from ordinary everyday things like keeping houses warm and driving cars, which meant if they made less CO2, maybe they could save the land for the children.
Is there a happy ending?
It's up to us how the story ends. See what you can do. Search online for Act on CO2.
Colson, just watching that. That particular segment, it's really powerful how what we do, we talk about, we love our children and we want the very best for them, we want the very best for their future. But as we've seen in that video, what we do is going to actually directly impact the kind of future that they have.
Yeah.
And do you feel as though, once again, this is being covered in enough detail to raise awareness? You know, we've spoken about amongst people. What about amongst children? Do you think enough is being done to raise awareness amongst youths in schools, colleges, universities?
So I certainly agree that education is the best method to tackle climate change.
Mm. Is enough being done, do you think?
Certainly not. If enough was being done, I'd have some hope left that, okay, maybe we can fight this. But at the moment, it's not being done, which is why we're here today to talk to you, to talk to the youth, to educate and to spread awareness that nothing is, like, not enough is being done, and people need to realize this. Mm. And it's not... we know that it's not like as individuals, you can do a lot. I know most of it's down to big corporate companies, but as individuals and as Muslims, you have an obligation to perform. Mm. Recycling is an obligation upon you. Don't waste. Mm. Live in modesty and modernity. You know.
Mm-hmm. Manadia, really interesting what Kulsoom is trying to cover there. Do you feel, is it just in developing countries that this is happening, or is it also happening in developed countries?
It's happening in developed countries, like Latifa said, in the USA. Okay. And we can see it within the UK as well. There's flooding, and it's not, I mean, we've had like a very long summer as well. I mean, we've enjoyed it, but the thing is, what we don't understand is, even though we've enjoyed some aspects of global warming, people across the world aren't. People are dying because of it. I think what the most important thing when it comes to climate change is, it's a simple issue, right? There's a problem that's been created by humans because we're doing something. We're burning fossil fuels, we're not recycling, you know, we're not living efficiently. And what's happening is the direct implication is people suffering, people dying. And within the Muslim community, as in, like, we're massive charity givers. We've always been ones to, if there's refugees or if there's a crisis, we're always the first at the scene to help them. But this is what we're trying to say, is we need to look at the source of these issues. We're going to have climate refugees. We're going to have people dying. Over 500,000 people will start dying every year because of climate change. It's not a faraway issue. It's a now issue. Mm. And the simple thing is, we need to act. That's it.
Okay. Latifa, it's quite interesting, you know, just hearing that answer, that we are very giving when it comes to charity. But are we giving charity for the very thing that we're causing in the first place? That's what it seems to me.
Yeah, absolutely, actually.
In a lot of cases.
In many cases, the natural disasters that we're seeing are not so natural. They're actually man-made, and they're the consequence of our actions as human beings who are, in many ways, we've been too greedy and we've taken too many of the resources of the earth. And that's why we're now seeing, you know, heat waves happening in places like Pakistan. You know, we're seeing, you know, flooding take place more frequently. And we're not just seeing that at home here in, you know, places like Somerset or in the south of the UK, but in the most poorest and vulnerable countries. And so ultimately, we have to ask ourselves, you know, how often can we say that climate change is, you know, it's not the most important topic? And often it's not, you know, within the community. But yeah, you're right. It's the issue that we've caused, and we need to take responsibility for it.
Sure. Kulsoom, Latifa spoke about how it's affected America, and, you know, it's a developed country. Now, from your knowledge, you know, we had the recent elections. Mm-hmm. Was climate change, global warming, I can't recall being mentioned.
It wasn't.
By some of the candidates.
I mean, it's quite controversial.
Okay.
Topic within the American elections.
Sure.
But no.
You'd think, you know, if the country is directly being impacted, the first thing you'd want to say is, look, we need to do something about this.
It's true, but you'd be surprised how we have all of this evidence, we have all of these disasters happening, and yet there are people who just deny climate change is a thing. It's a natural occurrence, but it's so evident, and it's absolutely, like, crazy that things are happening right there before your eyes, and you're still just going to ignore it.
Manadia, why is that? That's very concerning and worrying.
It's true. But I think, I mean, there's a lot of factors that surround people's denial of climate change. A lot of it is associated to financial reasons and stuff like that, especially within certain governments. I mean, there is a lot of cost that comes associated with becoming more eco-friendly or looking for renewable energy sources. But what people don't see is the longer term effects of it. We're going to gain in the long run. And as in, like, we live in a culture, especially within our home, like living in the UK and in the West, of it's like a consumerist culture, and, you know, we throw things away and stuff like that. But when we look at our grandparents and, you know, our people that first came to this country, I mean, it's evident, like, when you open the fridge and you see a butter tin, it's not a butter tin anymore. It's usually got a bit of curry in it. You know, we have that recycling mentality, but it's slowly going away. I don't think we're at despair.
Does that happen in your house?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, okay, like, okay. You get disappointed, you open the cookie tin and there's no
cookie. It'd be interesting to see if viewers at home also do the same.
Yeah, so, I mean, I don't think we're at despair. I think we have it within us, be it Islamic or cultural. We have this identity. We have, it's part of identity and our morality that we need to take care of the planet and we need to do things. So yeah, recycling your biscuit tin or your butter tin, you know, this is the first start to the rest of it.
Okay. Latifa, can you give us some real examples of how people have been affected in different countries? You mentioned a few countries. So say, for example, what kind of things are happening in Bangladesh?
So in Bangladesh, particularly, it's the most disaster-prone country in the world, and it's where my family are from.
Sure.
And I've, you know, been fortunate to see for myself firsthand how, for example, one of the areas most affected by Cyclone Ayla, which hit Bangladesh in 2009, that's caused the land that most people grow their food on to now become affected by salination, which is basically, it's too salty for them to be able to grow even vegetables. And that means that will effectively lead to malnutrition amongst their children.
Sure.
And that in turn leads to, you know, mortality rates and children not being able to go to school, you know, children dying. We're seeing so many effects of climate change, but the biggest cost is losing lives. You know, some of these families that we've spoken to and I've met have lost their children in floods just because, you know, they didn't have houses that were, you know, built on slabs of pavement, for example.
Sure.
So there are simple and effective ways where we could prevent more lives being lost. But that is one of the main reasons people are not able to grow their own foods.
And agriculture is, for a lot of people in Bangladesh, their primary income.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, this is why, you know, we need to stop being so selfish in this country. Ultimately, we need to stop thinking about buying from, you know, massive sort of, you know, retail outlets, and instead investing in more, you know, fair and locally and sourced food, because that means a fairer cut for those farmers back home. And ultimately, that is what we should be doing.
Mm. And Kulsoom, in terms of, you hear that and it really worries you. It really worries. Why do you feel that there are governments out there who, you know, we spoke about this, about America, but, you know, to me, should this not be on the priority list for a country like Bangladesh, who's been impacted by it the most?
Yeah, certainly. So, Like Munadia said earlier, it's not in the interest of the governments at the moment or within our sort of capitalist system where if we turn more eco-friendly, you know, what's going to happen to the oil companies?
Sure.
So for them, it's not in their best interest. And we all, as we know, like in terms of demographics and who runs the economy, the oil companies will lose out. So it's not in their interest.
Mm-hmm.
However, you know, that's an entire country that's going to be underwater.
Mm.
So it is in the interest of states to recognize that, you know, this is an entire state that will be essentially disappeared.
Sure. And in terms of countries in Africa, what kind of countries are really being affected?
So it's interesting that you asked that, because recently, just about 2 weeks ago, we attended COP22, which is a convention that different countries go to in order to talk about climate change. And whilst we were there, it was in Marrakesh, which is in Africa, we got to visit the Sahara Desert, and we did a three-day trek there to raise money for charity. And what we did was we walked across the desert, and we would see like patches of dry land, and it wasn't desert land, it was just dry land. And this was the direct cause of desertification. So land that couldn't be, that land that previously had water on it or crops couldn't grow on it. And so you could, like, it was shocking for us, because we're climate campaigners, but it's the first time we saw it at hand.
Sure,
and the reason why we did this challenge was for Niger, another country in Africa that suffers from desertification. So it's quite evident that it's happening right now.
Sure. And what about countries like Morocco? Are they affected, Latifa?
Yeah, absolutely. Like Monadia says, that drought is a big issue in those countries that are, you know, almost abundantly blessed with sunshine, but that's a result of climate change. You know, our actions in the developed world are causing people to ultimately, you know, not have water sources in the future. You know, having access to water is going to be, you know, probably going to cause a massive war. And that's something that we need to be aware of. And Morocco has, you know, taken a lead, though, in adopting environmentally friendly practices, though. As you know, Monadia mentions, the UN climate conference took place in Morocco, and they have committed to having 600 of their mosques switch to renewable energy, which is a massive step forward for any Muslim, you know, country. So we are seeing that, you know, a country like Morocco has lots of beautiful green land, and now it's starting to realise the benefits of switching to eco-friendly approaches.
Okay, and. Why should, you know, there are people at home watching this, why should people in the UK, we've spoken about that it's quite, you know, it's in the distant future, so it doesn't affect us. Why should people live in the UK be seriously worried about climate change?
Well, I think that anybody who, you know, really cares about justice and has a sense of, you know, morality and responsibility towards other human beings generally should care about this issue. But those in the UK particularly, you know, because we are blessed and privileged, we have access to so many things that people around the world don't. And also, I think people shouldn't be... you know, disillusioned by any way at all. We're already seeing the hot, much more hot summers and much more cold winters. So it's in our own interest, actually, to be caring about the issue of climate change.
Sure. And Kultum, you know, the Muslim population in this country, they're notoriously renowned for being so generous when it comes to charity. This in itself is charity, right?
Alhamdulillah, yes. They are renowned for being the best in charity. It is a charity because, you know, you are helping out our own Muslim, or I mean, university brothers and sisters. However, because it is a man-made problem, it is our own issue. And it's sort of like it just goes back into a cycle where we're creating the problems and then we're donating to release the problems and then we continue to create the problems. So we are the creators of the problems and then we're the ones to release the problems too.
And with climate change, Kultum, it's one of those, you know, charities where it's not costing us anything, but yet we're doing charity work. Because sometimes there might be people, you know, there's so many appeals that are done on this show, on this particular channel, and some people can't donate. But just by, for example, recycling, someone is actually directly giving charity,
absolutely,
if we look at it like that, because you're saving another country.
Absolutely. So you don't have to contribute via money. You can just contribute via your own environment, you know, lead a lifestyle that at least reflects that, you know, you are caring for humanity, you are caring for the environment, you are a steward of the earth, and you just want to show that, you know, you're not living in a way that shows that you're contributing to to climate change.
Brilliant. Now, that's the end of segment one. Please stay with us join us after the break when we will carry on with this very interesting and much needed discussion on climate change. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to Youth Matters. Now, on today's show, we are looking at climate change and the impact that climate change is having around the world and what it is that we could do individually and as a community to try and tackle this issue. Asko amra climate change liya matha dasi. Ar amra dekhnan akhtata temperature, akhtata weather, ekho dekhshain to maze beshi mega yoy nani nae, beshi meg nai, manche solta farana, tantan o mani khoshto takhte. So, ikta khene hoy. আমরা কিছু করতাম পারমুনি যে একটা সাহায্য হইব আরও হরণ না খেনে কতটা খরা যায় ক্লাইমেট চেঞ্জে ট্যাকল করবার দেয় একটা খেনে হরণ না একটু হইলো আপনারা আসো আপনারা প্লিজ ফোন হরোক আপনারা যখন কিছু কোয়েশ্চেন থাকে আপনারা কিছু বুঝরা না জানতা চাই না আপনি আমরা কোয়েশ্চেন জিকাউকা আর আমরা আনসার করতাম পারবো দিস শো অ্যাজ অলওয়েজ ইজ ইউ নো ইটস অ্যাবাউট দ্য ইউথ অ্যান্ড উই ওয়ান্ট টু হিয়ার ফ্রম ইউ Please, the number's on the screen. You've also got access to email. So if you don't want to speak, do email us and we'll share that on the show. But tell us, what are your views about climate change? How seriously have you understood it? How serious of a concept is it to you? Is it something that actually resonates with you in your day-to-day life? Or is it something that you don't even think about? I would really like to know. And obviously you can remain anonymous. Adil, thank you for joining us for the second segment. Now, you've traveled. And sure. You've seen the devastating effect of climate change.
Unfortunately, yes.
Okay, so please tell me about some of your experiences.
Well, I feel that a year ago, maybe possibly even longer, I wasn't necessarily aware of climate change and its impacts on the world. But I was very, very fortunate enough to have traveled with the charity Islamic Relief, where I was, traveled up to Niger in Africa. And as I got there, as you can imagine, Miss Africa is just desert upon desert. There's absolutely nothing there for miles upon miles. And as we finally got closer to this village, all of a sudden I saw greenery. I saw greenery. But it was very little, very little. And so I asked our colleagues, I said, where is the crops? Where's the food? Where's the water? How are these people surviving here? He says, well, unfortunately, my friend, this is the impact of climate change, where unfortunately due to greed and unfortunately due to droughts and so many different parameters and issues, we find ourselves in places where there's a lack of food, lack of clean water. Now, of course, what does that mean? That means a lot of hunger. It means a lot of malnutrition. It means a lack of, hygiene. And then, of course, nutrition. Very, very important basic needs of a human. But alhamdulillah, I was really, really happy to see that an amazing project that Islamic Relief and these amazing superstars, which are the climate action and climate justice fighters, as I call them, amazing individuals, they fought for this project and they really funded this project, which was more about creating a solution. What was the solution? Well, the solution was to reinvest in the people, the local individuals, to provide them seeds. Seeds that would then grow. So what Islamic Relief did was, they began to dig deep into the grounds so that the water did not place above the ground, so that the sun did not hit it straight. If the sun was to hit that straight above, what would happen is the water then evaporate.
Sure.
Due to the blistering heat. I mean, I think it's 40 to 50 degrees out there.
Okay.
But so the water now started to collate beneath the soil. And so what that did was that gave the seeds an opportunity to grow. Oh, SubhanAllah.
Thank you.
SubhanAllah.
Thank you.
Amazing.
That's fascinating. Latifa, tell me from your experience, Adil's described it, and it's fascinating to hear what his experience is. Well, what about your experiences?
Well, going to some of the worst affected areas in the southwest of, Bengal, in Bangladesh, myself, I've seen how, some of the communities we're working in, which ultimately their livelihoods comes from fishing. The Bangladeshi community are well known for, their fish, fish livelihoods. Unfortunately, because of the flooding and the after effects of flooding, which affect the water, a lot of those communities have not been able to fish. And so we've been in a fortunate position within Islamic Relief to be able to support those communities by providing them with equipment and also tools and the knowledge and training to be able to fish in some of those areas that were affected. We've also, in some of the areas where Cyclone Ayla most affected Bangladesh, we've built solar powered homes. Now that's quite innovative, and actually one of the most effective ways for us to help some of these communities is by showing them that they also don't need to contribute to climate change like we do.
Now, Latifa, for me, we have a lot of viewers watching this, and they're probably they're probably cooking fish curry at
yes.
home. Now, what you're saying is, it begs to ask the question that a lot of the fish that's being actually exported over here, should we be worried about the fish that we're buying? Because if the water is being contaminated, then is that not affecting the fish?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think, that's definitely a question we should be asking ourselves. This is why earlier when I mentioned looking to locally sourced produce is good for us. Because then it means that the communities like in Bangladesh who are able to fish, they're those poor individuals who can fish can then actually take those fish and sell them to the market and earn money back for their families. Mm-hmm. So in for us, it's about empowering the community and letting them keep hold of whatever resources and whatever little they're able to produce. Mm-hmm. But like we've spoken already in this mm-hmm. show, it's because of the demand of Absolutely. The developed world and mm-hmm. us, the rich, that the poor are suffering.
Yeah, Kultum, what would be your message to people who sell fish in this country? If there's someone who's watching this at home and they supply fish to their community here in this country, what would you say to them? Because surely, if these fishes are not good for our health and they're contaminated, then should we not be thinking twice? Should we be the due diligence process mm-hmm. of actually bringing these fishes over? Should we not be doing more checks? Should they be much more concerned now that they've heard some of the stuff that you guys have said?
Certainly, there should definitely be more sort of restrictions and like risk assessments, I suppose, of the fishes. And it gives us a chance as well to reflect on our moderation of our food consumption, not just regarding to fish, but like meat, which is one of the major contributors mm. to climate change and the emissions. And it's something we in the Muslim community have to definitely look at our meat consumption, because it's ridiculous. Mm-hmm. And at the rate that we're going, if we continue to eat meat, we're going to
struggle.
Yeah, very much.
Absolutely.
Okay, Adil, what other items that are commonly used in people's households here in the UK would you say are affected by climate change?
Well, it's probably the other way around. What are we doing to increase climate change? And that's the worry. That's okay. the worry. I mean,
in terms of we'll cover that.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
So in terms of at the moment, so we spoke about fish sure. being an item, because we've got people at home, for example, probably yeah. now thinking, fish, a bit worried now. Okay. Mm. And what else do I need to be aware of when I'm going out there shopping? Because obviously I don't want my family to be affected.
Of course. I think regardless of what it is that you purchase, we should just be quite conscious of making sure it's ethically sourced. Okay. Latifa touched upon it earlier on in the show, and I think it's absolutely correct. Whatever you purchase, whether it be garments, whether it be food products, or whether it be any kind of toiletries or whatever it is, you need to ensure that these are locally sourced as much as possible, because that way you're not impacting someone else, a farmer maybe up in Scotland or someone across the world. That locally sourced is very, very, very important, and I feel that will help us a lot going forward in the future if we are to sustain ourselves in a positive manner.
Sure. And Latifa, what kind of things are we doing that's contributing to global climate change?
So, at a local level, there are some things that we're doing which are in excess. So, for example, we're using, energy and electricity. Mm. For example, and a lot of the time, we're not thinking about how much we're using it. Because we live in this throwaway society, we think we've got abundant energy, actually, when really we don't. And we could be switching to, for example, energy-saving bulbs, at home. And those are one of the things that people can do. And actually, many local councils and government schemes will support families and local communities, and they're cheaper as well in many cases. So we need to be thinking about our actions at home. There are other things that we can be doing, for example, looking at the kind of foods that we are buying and making sure that they're not, as a result of use of pesticides or overuse of water. That's also an issue in Muslim and particularly Bengali households, the waste of water, because we are, we love our food, we love our fish, we love our curries, but we don't actually need to be washing some things like chicken excessively, or we don't.
After what you've said about the contamination, should we not be washing it even more?
Yeah, I think we have to, of course, ensure that the fish that we are buying is, of course, sourced from a good, kind of ethically sourced shop. And that's ultimately where we'll be able to mitigate some of those issues.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Now, before we watch another video, I'm going to quickly ask you a question, Kultum. What other? So, Latifa's spoken about we could switch off the lights, okay, when it's not being used. We need to make sure that we're not wasting water. What else would you advise the people watching at home?
Okay, so cycle.
Okay.
Yeah, especially in London, you don't need to drive around when we have such amazing transport systems over here.
Even in the winter?
Yeah, in the winter, why not just double up on the coats and be padded up before you go, and you'll actually be saving a lot, not just for climate change, but for yourself, for your own health, you know.
And what do you say to some people who will argue that the fatality rate of bikes,
okay, well,
you know, is a factor as to why a lot of people don't.
I do understand that, and yeah, we do need to let Sadiq Khan know about certain cycle routes and how there should definitely be more safety on the roads.
Thank you. I'll come back to you. So we're going to watch another short video on climate change.
Cycling won't make the world more green, they said. I agree. But no one said being eco-friendly is a single person's dream. The climate is in our hands, so be easy on the taps. More water saved to feed the soil and fill green gaps. Energy focused on beneficial life-saving usage. Simple things can change the world if we put our minds to it.
Climate change is something that affects all of us.
Not only is it about my children and their future and, you know, the sort of world I want them to live in, but also because how we behave today, right now, still affects those who are living in other parts of the world.
To imagine 15% of arable Egypt and Bangladesh being taken out because of coastal sea level rises and salinization.
Waste has a direct impact on climate change, as most of our waste ends up in landfill sites.
We all should be striving to have more balance in our lives, and one of the ways that we can do that is simply just by recycling a lot more.
As we are now, we are using too much resources, much more than what our Earth can supply for us, and much more than what we can sustain.
The most important thing is there will be a ripple effect over time. And if we can set an example for generations to come, then that focus will be core in their principles and values. Climate change is real, and climate change affects us.
So as a Muslim,
I think we should be more energy efficient.
I believe we should reduce our product consumption.
Encourage the installation of biodiverse roofs.
And support the purchasing of local produce.
We need to create and conserve green spaces.
Climate change affects us all, so for me, it's not about losing hope and feeling alone. It's about taking action collectively and feeling powerful together.
So that was a short video just reinforcing what we're discussing today about climate change and the impact it has and why we need to work together to ensure that we tackle this, you know, concerning issue. Now, we've had a lot of emails on this. We've had someone from London who wants to remain anonymous saying people need to realise as Muslims it is our responsibility to look after the planet and we'll be individually accountable. Therefore, please turn off your taps when brushing teeth, doing wudu, don't use unnecessary water, pick up litter and not to waste food. And then we've got someone else in London saying Muslim community needs more awareness at mosques, community centres. The youth need to engage more and ensure future is in better position for them. So thank you, and please, you know, do keep your emails coming. Coming back to Adil, so we spoke about obviously using bikes despite the dangerous roads in London. What else would you say we need to do more of to tackle it locally?
Less consumption. I feel that today we live in a time where consumption is just everywhere. It's everywhere around us. We're buying more clothes than we need. We're eating more than we need to, unfortunately. You know, that's probably why gym memberships have increased. We're just doing more than what we need to in terms of for ourselves and our desires. But actually what we should do is do more for the community. Do more for the environment. Really appreciate what Allah has actually provided us, what God has given us in this earth. And if you start to do those just lifestyle changes within yourself, then you'll actually begin to accept and understand that climate change is real. It's when you believe that climate change is not happening, it's not real, that's the real danger. So if we can make those lifestyle choices, as you've kind of alluded towards and as that wonderful video alluded towards, we will actually make a huge difference. Maybe not individually, but together. Mm. Together we can actually benefit society and environment.
Sure, small action, big changes.
Absolutely.
Latifa, tell me this. So Adil spoke about lifestyle changes. So what kind of things, what else do we need to be doing? Because there are people watching at home thinking, okay, I want to actually be part of this change. What do I do?
Yeah, and I think this is the fantastic thing that everybody can do something.
And it doesn't cost them anything.
And it doesn't cost them anything
most
at all.
Most of the time.
Exactly.
It saves them money because if we start buying,
Absolutely. We'd be saving a lot more money. And a lot of these tips that we will be sharing in this show as well, like for example using energy saving light bulbs. Even in mosques, for example, some of the mosques, and I know of initiatives like an initiative called Green Up My Community, which has helped mosques to look at the prophetic example of reducing water waste. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was known to use like a Coca-Cola can worth of water to make wudu. And actually that, is something that we could challenge ourselves to, as young people and as communities. Sure. Why don't we do a wudu challenge, a wudu challenge where we're not wasting and leaving the tap on and, splashing water everywhere. Mm. Instead, restricting ourselves to use a small amount of water. We can also start the conversation in our communities and in our families. Mm. And I think that's a really important point. And talking to young people, especially even at home, I know I encourage my parents, and it's become like a crime not to recycle in our family now. Good. Because my dad is very keen to make sure that we're recycling everything. Those are the kinds of conversations we need to be having at home, so we can educate our community and the youth can also educate their elder community. And lastly, I think one of the really great things about our community, especially the British Bangladesh community, we love to grow our own vegetables. And I know that many Bangladeshi families like to have garden competitions, as it were, to see who grows the best vegetables. So by growing our own food, we'll also be relying a lot less on food that has pesticides, etc.
I think that's really helpful. Kultum, you recently went on a UN climate conference. What were the key messages from the leaders who were delivering that conference?
So it's 1.5 to stay alive, which is basically we need to bring down our global temperatures, which is currently exceeding 2 degrees. So we need to bring that down, and that is the main message. And the main point of the climate change conference was for the countries to agree on certain policies that will take place and actually implement. And we went there as young Muslims to learn about what are these and what sustainable methods we can bring back and then spread awareness, inshallah, amongst our own communities.
We've got a call on the line. Thank you. I'll come back to you, Kulsoom. Assalamu alaikum, caller.
Walaikum salam.
How would you, sister, how would you like to contribute to the discussion?
So my question is, and to pretty much everyone, is that we're talking a lot about individual change, but I heard that you all are campaigners, so what can we do to actually campaign on this issue?
Yeah, I think that's a brilliant question. Thank you, sister. Adil, please answer the question.
Yeah, please. A year ago, I was very fortunate enough to have gone to the COP21.
That's fine.
One just before this, and that was in Paris. And it really, it woke me up to so many things. Okay. And honestly, what I found there was similar to what Kulsoom just mentioned. Young Muslim men and women campaigning for justice, climate justice. And we kept saying, what do we want? Climate justice. When do we want it now? It was amazing. Honestly, it was amazing. And we found all sorts of individuals, regardless of race, religion and backgrounds, they were all united for that one element, which is campaigning. And I know, we have a wonderful colleague called Ziaur Rahman, who is such a huge advocate for it. And so please, please, please do get involved, honestly, because we are here to support and we need more challenges there.
Sure. Latifa, so Kola asked about, and Adil alluded to that, campaigning. So how would campaigning for climate change look like?
So some of the things that some of our campaigners are already doing, and these guys have been doing when they've been going out, is actually lobbying their MPs. Brilliant. To raise climate change as an important issue within government. Mm. Unfortunately, the government that is now in place in the UK doesn't see climate change as a priority. And this is why we need the Muslim voice on this issue and for them to go to their MPs and to say, actually, we know that climate change is affecting some of the most poorest communities that we're from. We're from these diaspora communities like Pakistan, like Bangladesh, and we want to see the UK government actually live up to the pledges that they've made at these national conferences that we've attended. So ultimately, there are other things that people can do. They can also join the climate movement. We have a number of campaign actions. There's also the Climate Action Week, which is a time where we've been raising awareness. They can also attend workshops and training workshops to learn more about climate change.
Sure. Kulthum, what else in terms of campaigning? So one way is to lobby our MPs. What else can we do?
So as individuals, you can just start a conversation, talk to your neighbour, talk to people on the street, people or your colleagues at work or your friends at school. This just starting the conversation is so much because, we live in an age where information is everywhere. It should be illegal not to be aware, So just a simple discussion and somebody could suddenly turn what would they never be recycling water bottles or plastics, and how much plastics have they just saved? I remember when we were in Morocco, I was told that one plastic bottle will go on 500 years beyond your life. So a plastic bottle will, because that's how long it takes to degrade. And you obviously, as an individual, will take less time. So one plastic bottle will take 500 years more than you to degrade. Imagine that in terms of...
Of course. And Adil, in terms of, obviously we know as Muslims, if someone starts something good and everyone who follows that, they get the reward of it as well, without
Absolutely.
That person's reward.
Yeah.
And so I guess this is a brilliant opportunity for us to actually, and Kulthum alluded to the fact that, starting initiatives in the workplace. So what kind of things could people do? Because there might be people watching at home. We spoke about things we can do at home. What can you, and we spoke about, using butter containers to put curries, and I'm sure we do that anyway, but what can we do at work?
Absolutely. Okay, well, I mean, Kulthum raised a wonderful point, which is that this climate change is because of an attitude and a culture that now exists.
Sure.
But just the way that culture exists, we can change it. We can create a new culture, a positive culture. So at work, for example, what we do is we ensure that we have the recyclable opportunities. We ensure that when we are eating, we're eating, with an ethical mind. We're not just buying random frozen products and random products that are, say, made in Taiwan. And you're thinking, well, how did it get here? All the air miles and taking food away from another person's mouth. We have loads of local produce here in the UK. We're very fortunate. Amazing farms, halal farms as well. Fishmongers, an amazing coast we have across the UK. So we don't necessarily need to go far out. So right at work, you can start recycling. You can start, for example, walking or cycling to work. You can start to actually eat better, eat less, and what you need as opposed to what you desire. I think those small but huge positive changes can make a world of difference.
Brilliant. Latifa, so we had Kulthum talking about, what's happening and some of the things that we could do in our at work. Adil spoke about work as well. In terms of with our community, so we spoke about the mosques, okay? And you spoke about the competition with the wudu. I don't really know how that's going to work. But what other things can we do as a community? In terms of initiatives, would you say people should start looking at?
Definitely. I think there are lots of creative initiatives that I've already seen within the community. So one of our campaigners actually is known and for her creative talents in recycling clothes. So one of the things that we see is, particularly amongst the Asian community, we buy in excess or the kind of clothes that, we would like for lavish occasions, but then we never reuse those reuse that material. So we can reuse that material in many different ways. So upcycling, buying a lot less. So,
so some people might not be familiar with the term upcycling. Do you want to just quickly explain what it is?
So upcycle means to buy, when you buy something and then you find another purpose for it, essentially.
So say, for example, if there was old curtains and we could make them into pillowcases.
Yeah, absolutely.
Would that be upcycling?
Yeah, absolutely. So we're not wasting that material, as it were, even clothes. So, I've seen a very fantastic example from one of our campaigners. She's used that material to decorate umbrellas with or decorate furniture with at home. So, there are really creative and engaging ways people can, make change in their community. We've seen some of our campaigners come together in the community to actually, around Ramadan time, we've seen a huge amount of waste of water bottles in our mosques, because of course we need our water to get through Tarawih prayers, but what do people do with those water bottles afterwards? They just chuck them and don't recycle them.
Thank you, Latifa. We're getting a lot of emails coming in today. We've got someone else who doesn't want to be named from London saying people are wasting too much resources. People can walk more and use public resources. Example, people dropping kids off with the car to school or rushing to mosque for prayer in their cars. So walking instead. We've had Yusuf, who's 7 years old, saying don't put rubbish in the in the water as it pollutes the rivers and the fish and water. Creatures can survive. So mashallah, you know, it's really nice to hear. And I'd really like our young brothers and sisters who are watching this to get involved and tell us what else will you do, inshallah, and what else would you encourage others to do. Kusum, coming back to you, you know, we're looking at obviously solutions in terms of what else we can do to try and tackle this issue. What would be your message to our young people watching at home who want to do something? You know, why should they take this matter so seriously?
Because this is not just for us. We have to think about this is potentially the future of civilization, you know. It's your children, your children's children, and right now we're just about living okay, comfortably, but I give it a few decades and we live in London City, you know, we can see right now the health problems from all the pollution, asthma and all these other different health problems that are occurring are because of this, and it's for our own benefit, for the benefit of us as humans and for our environment, you know.
We're talking about upcycling, recycling, mm-hmm. and amongst the youth, I guess the message we're trying to get across is, you know, for them to upcycle and for them to recycle. Mm-hmm. But with youth culture, sometimes it's very difficult because they want to be, you know, up to date with the latest kind of gadgets, with the latest, you know, clothing lines and so forth. So how do you kind of tackle that? It's a tough one.
It is a tough one, and it has a lot more to do with, you know, who are those who target the youth in terms of, you know, mass consumption of clothes, of old products, and it is obviously corporations because they need the money for their own benefits, and for the corporations are the ones who, you know, they give us all of these products, we use them and then we waste it, and then you know, it just turns into a big cycle and it goes round and round.
Adil, would you know, some people might say the reason why I buy a lot of clothing is because I'm not wasting it, I give it back to charity. You've got so many clothing banks, around the country, so And they will argue that, look, it's not going to waste. Mm. Is that, in your opinion, a valid argument?
Well, it's a valid argument per se. It's just the problem is you're not really dealing with the core issue. The core issue is consumption. Let's be honest. Let's be completely frank about this. Yes, of course, it's wonderful for me to buy a garment and then donate another garment to charity. It sounds wonderful in principle. But what we should be doing is understanding the actual need. Is there a need to buy that extra garment? Is there actually a need? And I think that upcycling is a wonderful idea because there's so many things happening. I mean, look, we come from a household now. I have three sisters. My three sisters, they would always just hand me down. I used to take a lot of my dad's stuff. You know, so I used to...
With his permission.
Yeah. With his well, on some occasions. But yeah, so I would be, you know, very excited to wear the jeans that my dad once wore, or the shoes that my dad once wore. You know,
that's very brave.
He was very cool. He was very, very cool. But that's the thing. We need more role models. Yeah. Really pushing that message home. And I think in schools, we're doing some great work now as well. There's some phenomenal teachers who are really pushing the campaign as well. There are phenomenal volunteers who are working within schools or within, you know, in and around children. And more importantly, and one thing you will see, is our volunteers. These volunteers are giving up their time, their efforts to be here today to speak about these campaigns because they believe in it and they want to make a difference to the environment.
Sure, brilliant. We've got another email from Aisha, who's 10 years old, saying, walk more as pollution from cars causes greenhouse gases. If we don't do anything, the ice will melt and cause flooding in many countries. Mashallah. So it's really inspiring to see so many of our young brothers and sisters getting involved. We really want to hear from our youth, okay? If you go to school, college, university, tell us what kind of initiatives are these institutions running to try and tackle this issue? And if they're not, what are you going to do? After listening to our expert opinions, it is now your responsibility to do something about it. So please phone us up and tell us what you will do so it inspires those who are watching as well. Coming back to you, Latifa, we're obviously looking at solutions and trying to think about what else we can do. Would you say, you know, there are parents and there are young people watching at home, what other advice would you give in terms of what they need to do? Because I think people probably have understood, okay, climate change is actually happening here and now, and we need to do something about it. I can do this and that. But in terms of raising awareness and within the household, and Adil spoke about taking the initiative to actually lead by example and be good role models, what kind of things could we be doing? What else?
Well, I think particularly as, you know, young people with a lot of energy and passion and zeal, you know, young people are in the best place. And I'm so impressed with, you know, these 10-year-olds and 7-year-olds who, you know, understand. Yeah, they understand the impact that even our small actions, like, you know, not walking or taking the car for a 5-minute drive, the impact that can have on the earth. It goes to show that the young people and actually this generation are a lot more, in power to be able to change what could happen in the future. So I would say what they should do is to talk and to, you know, I know it's not the most attractive topic to talk about. It's not the most trendy topic, but they can talk to their friends and at school, and they can start that conversation. And I think that's the only way that we're going to change some of the behaviors and attitudes and trends in society, because becoming green should be something which is really trendy, actually. Because it's a Muslim responsibility, and that's the way we're going to start changing the conversation.
Absolutely. It's a sunnah. It's a sunnah. That's the beauty of it. It's a sunnah. You know, we're talking about trends. What better trend could we ever find than the one of the blessed Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? I mean, this is the trend that we should be following. And, you know, the beards and, you know, the hijab, and, you know, we have our prayers. And
prophet.
Yeah, they're amazing. But exactly. But we want to benefit the environment as well. So like what Khulsum mentioned, for the next generation and these beautiful 10 and 7-year-olds here who are really urging their family members to say, look, let's walk, not drive. It's for them. And I hope they have a wonderful upbringing. And most importantly, I hope that they bring benefit upon this earth as well.
Inshallah. I mean, Khulsum, tell me this. So say, for example, I know there are political challenges. Some people take it seriously. Some are not prioritizing it like they should do. If you could say something to the, you know, Prime Minister of this country, imagine, you know, hopefully she's watching this at home. What would you say to her? What would be your message about climate change?
I don't even know what to say, because I would just want to take her
in the nicest possible way. Yeah. We want her to say yes.
I would want to take her and to show her, because maybe that's the only way you can truly realize is when you see with your eyes, because people can speak and they can speak a lot and it goes in one ear and out the other. It's just something, it's a problem of the distant future.
Sure, I'm going to come back to you on that. We've just got a caller on the line. Salaam alaikum, caller.
Walaikum salam. I just wanted to say that you're all doing an amazing job, and I'm very passionate about climate change. I just wanted to ask, obviously, no matter how much you raise awareness, there are still going to be people who are ignorant. So do you think that individual choice really makes a difference?
Okay. I'll come back to you, Khulsum. Adil, how would you answer that?
Absolutely. Absolutely, sister. Because ultimately, look, the four of us are having this conversation, okay? And all the wonderful individuals watching at home. So it took an individual to inspire another individual and then to keep that chain reaction going. And now this sister has inspired now a next caller or a next individual or a family member at home. And she has started her own wonderful, wonderful chain of positivity. Mm-hmm. So yes, it's individual. We know that. But that's the beauty of it. You're going to inspire a generation. You're going to inspire a group of people. And like they always say, if you teach a man, you teach an individual. You teach a woman, you teach a whole generation. So absolutely, sister, keep going. Inshallah.
And the brothers, please.
And the brothers. Yeah. Of course, we're always at the end, aren't we? We're always at the end.
Khulsum, coming back to you, so what you were saying, so carry on, please.
So in terms of telling world leaders that they need to wake up and they need to, I know they have all these talks and policies put in place, but it's up to us to actually implement them, and they need to make sure that they are being implemented and they're not just a little scribble on a page just to help, you know, stats go through. But they actually need to be taken very, very seriously, because the consequences are going to be disastrous.
Okay, thank you. Now, that concludes the second segment of this show on climate change. Do stay with us. In the third segment, what we will focus on is discussing campaigns and why it's so important that we are, you know, just like this. This is such an amazing campaign which impacts us directly. And looking at other campaigns as well, why is it that we need to be involved and aware of all the things that are going on? And what impact does that have on us, or does it? Okay. Alhamdulillah, amra asku discussion kora dasla. Amra second segment shesh hoye geche. Amra climate change holo ya. So apnara next segment to amra matmu aro koto jinish ase. Amra nani khorina. Koto da issues ase. Amra aro kita kora lagbo. Jela amra community shajjo korbo, amra individual shajjo korbo. Okta amra discuss korbo next segment. So amra loge thakba. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to the third segment of Youth Matters, where today we discuss the important topic of climate change and what we can do about it and what needs to be done. And alhamdulillah, we've had we've had an amazing show so far. Now, for the last segment, what we're going to focus on, climate change is it's an awareness campaign, and there are so many amazing awareness campaigns that are taking place. And what we want to focus on is the importance of campaigning, okay? And the different campaigns that exist and why it's in our interest and also the interest of the community, wider community, to actually be doing something about it. And that's what we'll focus on. Asko alhamdulillah amra climate change luya matisi amra fola duita segmento amra bla matmu khene mane khali gorobo ya kuchu na khora ta ki gya ita campaign luya khilaf ne manchore jana ita farba aro jinish korta farba zela shajjo ibo amra community amra manchore okta luya amra focus kormo third segmento. Okay, now what we're going to do, guys, is to start off with, you're all mashallah very passionate campaigners, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you, we're going to have a little competition, okay? And it's always good when it's related to good things, and I'm going to show you images on the screen, and I want you to look at the image and tell me what kind of campaign you think that particular image is showing, okay? And hopefully the images that we're going to cover will obviously link into some of the discussions we're going to have after that. Okay, now Mubin, you've joined us.
Yep.
Thank you. I'll start with you, so no pressure. Okay, so if we could have the first image on the screen, please. And please, at home, please join in and try and guess. And then I'll tell you whether you were right or wrong. Okay, so the first image that we have, it's not the background with cars. Yeah? Okay. So, what kind of campaign do you think that image is showing us? And you'll get two each, and I'll see who scores the highest at the end. And there's a bonus point if you can't. You can say pass. Have a guess. If you're watching this at home, try and, you know, mark yourself as well based on the answers.
I'd like to say, like, the neglection of elderly people.
Okay, interesting. Does anyone else want to challenge that? Yeah.
I feel like it's a suicide campaign.
Suicide awareness.
Yeah.
Or it could be something to do with maybe arthritis or some other muscular disease.
Okay. Munadi, I got that right. Okay, this is about suicide and the fact that, it's significantly high and amongst elderly people. So well done, even though that wasn't your question. Moving, you need to catch up. Okay. All right, can we have the second image, please? Okay, interesting. Manadia, this is for you to go 2-0 up on the others.
Yeah.
That's an easy one. What do you think that's about?
It's about animal abuse. Mm. So, lots of people use different animals, be it animal testing or in circuses and stuff, and, you know.
Fab. Yeah. Does anyone want to challenge that and try and get that bonus seems point? Moving, I think you need to come in here, yeah?
It seems pretty much straightforward. Like, it has to be that.
Yeah. You're wishing that, why didn't I get that? Okay. Yeah, you're absolutely right. And I think this is looking at, obviously, the abuse that a lot of animals face. And, we need to actually make sure that this isn't happening and we're not involved with that. Can we get the next image, please? All right, so, Kusum, for your first point.
It's interesting. Something to do with a silent killer, I suppose, or maybe domestic abuse. Yeah. I think domestic abuse.
Yeah, why would you say it's domestic abuse?
Because she has her hands to her lips to crush in the silence.
Her hand looks very manly, very hairy, I should say. So yeah. What do you think that's...
You can see that's a man's hand telling her to be quiet.
Anyone want to challenge that? No. Okay.
Yeah, the bruises on her eyes around, especially. Yeah. That
okay. So you're absolutely right. So that's about domestic violence and the fact that we need to raise awareness of that. Okay. So we've got 2-1, Mubin. You need to get this next one right. Okay. Can we have the next image, please? Do you know what? You seem to be getting all the tough ones. So this is a really interesting one. Oh. What do you think that's? What kind of awareness campaign is that trying to promote?
I'm gonna have to pass.
Yeah. Okay. Of course, I'm trying to.
Maybe something to do with taking foreign objects to, maybe animals, taking animals out of their natural habitat and putting them somewhere else.
I think
more idea?
Maybe the refugee crisis.
It's actually Kulsum's more on the right track. Okay, the fact that. You know, we're going to different countries and, you know, there are countries where they're abusing animals and obviously their skins are being used. So the sacrifice that's being made and the blood that people are carrying. Okay, so Kusum, 2-2. All right. All right. So the next one, can we have the next image, please? This is now getting competitive. Come on, Mubin, you're representing the male population here, yeah? The male youth, so there's no pressure. This is an easy one, okay? I've told the producer to make sure they give you an easy one.
Can't even make out what it says.
No, that's the whole idea, okay? What do you think? What would that?
It looks like a hearse.
I think.
Not your turn, Munadia, okay? Kusum, I think you need to be thinking what the answer could be. What do you think? So it's a car. What kind of car is it? I need to help you. I'm sorry, guys, yeah? Mubin.
Probably got to do with child death.
Ah, interesting.
Being high.
Okay, so child death, what kind of campaign could be promoting something like that? What kind of child, what could be causing?
What winter? I have no idea.
What do we do when we go into the car? thank you. Well done, Mubin. Okay.
That's a bit biased.
I think Mubin, he was alluding to that. Yeah. You know, he was going to get to that, but we're running out of time, so I had to help him right there. So you're absolutely right. This is about awareness about the fact that a lot of us don't put seatbelts on children when we're in cars, okay, and the damage and the effect that can have. Can we have the next image, please? Nadia.
This is an anti-smuggling campaign.
Yep, that's an easy one. And,
I mean, it's evident because they smoke in the air, and then it says children of parents who smoke get to heaven earlier. Yeah. And I mean, it's really sad because basically what it's trying to imply is that, you know, death is a consequence of parents smoking around their children.
And that, to be honest, because we had the answer, we're not going to give you that point. So that's a draw, guys. Well done. Yeah. But you did not too bad. Yeah, you got one right. Okay, we've got a caller on the line. Assalamu alaikum, caller. Walaikum
Assalam.
Brother, how would you like to contribute to the show?
I just want to say Islamic Relief is doing amazing work all across the world. I myself, I'm a volunteer. I think I've been volunteering for about 4 years now. And Islamic Relief is doing some amazing work. I just want everyone on Channel
Thank S you, brother.
The community to know that Islamic Relief is on the ground and we're supporting.
That's fine. Thank you. Okay. Now, we've been coming back to obviously... campaigns. There's so many amazing campaigns going on. Tell me about some of the campaigns that you've been involved with.
I've been volunteering for around 3 to 4 years now. I've been involved in the cake campaign.
Okay. Cake campaign?
Yeah, so on behalf of Islamic Relief, sending aid to Syria with cakes for Syria.
Okay.
The Yemen appeal, helping people in war-torn Yemen.
So when we're talking about campaigns, you know, war-affected countries, trying to raise awareness of
and
that.
And even the refugee crisis.
Sure, so the refugee crisis recently. As well, okay? Yeah. And what about you, Munadia? Tell me about the campaigns, you know, that you've been supporting.
So a lot of the campaigns that I work on are political and social. I mean, I aspire to become a politician, so I want to engage on those levels. So a few years back, one of the first campaigns I worked on was the UN Child's Rights Charter. And that I did with Youth Council, which I was part of. And when I got more involved in charity, I worked on various campaigns, including the Syria refugee campaign.
So going back to, you know, the first campaign that you were speaking about, give us a bit more information on that. You know, what kind of things were you trying to raise awareness about?
So one of the main things is that with any campaign, we have to look at humans as equally across the world. But what happens is the reality is that isn't the case. You have children all across the world, but because of where we're born, we have different rights. So what the UN was trying to do was enforce a certain certain rights across the world, so a generic right. So it was as basic as a child's right to play, a child's right to education. And so that's the kind of thing that we were trying to establish. But at that time, we were establishing it within our own community and ensuring that local schools and youth hubs and stuff like that were aware of it.
Kulsum, tell me about some of the campaigns you've been involved with.
So I've been campaigning for a few years now. I started off with the when the tuition fees were set up to £9,000, and I was in the first year group where it affected me the most.
Brilliant.
So since then, I got involved with a lot of other political activism.
Before we come back to the point you're making, can I take another caller? Assalamu alaikum, caller.
Wa alaikum assalam.
How would you like to get involved, sister?
I just have a question regarding this climate change thing.
Okay.
I just want to say, Munadi, I've been seeing your work and the stuff you do, and it's really inspirational.
Thank you.
My question is, how do young people like us get involved with Islamic Relief to help change?
So I think we'll come back to that question. I think it's a very important question. And going back to you, Kulsum, what would you say in terms of, we spoke about the tuition fees, and I think that's something obviously impacts a lot of people. Mm-hmm. So what did you learn on that journey?
Okay, so that's obviously concerning education, and education in this country, as students and young people know now, is just becoming ridiculous to think about going to university.
Off-putting was that to a lot of
people? It was very off-putting, and I know a lot of my friends didn't decide to go to university just because of that debt. But alhamdulillah, I was blessed that I could. True. I still made that decision where I thought, you know, in the long run, it will pay off.
Mm.
But for a lot of people, it's not. And we live here in the developed world, so I can't even imagine what it's like for people in developing countries.
Mm. Now, Mubin, tell me, what are some of the, you know, you guys have described, mashallah, amazing campaigns that you've been involved with. Tell me about other awareness campaigns, you know, national, international ones that we should be aware of that are currently taking place.
The refugee crisis. So a few months ago, I attended a protest, and I'm not really a protest person. I'm not an outgoing person.
That's fine.
But I decided to go along, and it was very insightful seeing people from all walks of life united on the same cause. The only difference between us and the people who are refugees now is the place that we were born in. It's not their fault that they were born in that place at that time.
Sure. And it could have been us instead of them, right? And that's what we need to always think about. Munadia, tell me, you know, there are people at home, for example, who might not be campaigners. Why should they be campaigning?
It depends. I mean, some people use faith, some people use passion. I mean, it comes from all different things. I think one of the biggest things that motivated me was faith and my accountability in taking care of the planet. And one of the most interesting analogies that were made is that our average lifespan is around 80 years. And the average lifespan, so for the climate campaign, an average lifespan of a bottle is 450 years. Once we're underground, this bottle will still be polluting the earth. And the thing is, it's going to be affecting generations after that. The reason why we do things is not only for ourselves, it's for the people around us, our obligation to take care of other people.
Sure. And Kulsum, you know, there are, Munadi has spoken about, obviously, from a religious perspective. You know, there are people out there that we all need to, if we're not active, nothing's going to get done.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to lead by example. What else would you say? Why else should someone get involved with campaigning?
I wouldn't. Campaigning is just so important. In fact, like all the rights that we currently have today, the fact that this weekend we have a Saturday off is because people campaigned and protested for having a weekend off. All our rights, and the fact that we as women can be here, that we have the right to vote, people campaign for these things.
Sure.
You have this TV channel here in the UK. It wouldn't have been very easy a couple of a decade or so ago. People campaigned against, you know, rights for minorities and against racism and against sexism. So and we only have these because of campaigning. So it's essential that campaigning is part of everybody's life.
Sure. Now, we've come to the end of this particular segment and the show. And I really hope that it's helped you in terms of trying to understand the importance of campaigning. We all have a part to play. Now, before we conclude, there's another caller who's been calling in. We'll take one last call. Caller, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
My name is Mohit Chaudhry, and I'm just calling to give my opinion on something. Yeah.
Really quickly, brother, because we're running out of time.
Oh, just quickly. I just want to say, Thingy, that I don't believe that the modern Western world, yeah, they'll care about climate change until it starts affecting them, until it starts like properly like affecting them, like as in a problem or something affecting them.
Sure. Thank you, brother. I think that's a really stronger opinion on that particular issue. And we've got another caller as well. Salaam alaikum, caller.
Wa alaikum salam.
Sounds like a familiar voice.
Yeah, a really good show, inshallah. I think it's such an important topic about how it affects all our lives. I just wanted to find out, you're talking about campaigning. I wanted to know how, if us obviously living in a developed world can make a difference, what about others as well in the developing countries? Mm-hmm. Do we all need to campaign to make a difference, or can some of us just sit at home and not do much?
Okay, thank you. I think that's a really, really good question. What would you say to that, Mubin?
I think everyone needs to get involved. It's a real life issue.
And what about people in developing countries? Because sometimes we just think that here in the West we need to scream and shout about some of the problems.
I think it affects them a lot as well. It's not just us that witness it. Like, these guys have been to the Sahara Desert. They've seen how Bedouins live. They found a dead camel out in the desert. I've seen pictures. It's not something that affects us, like, just here in the West. Mm. It's out there everywhere.
True. Thank you. Now, we've come to the end of the show, and hopefully what you've taken from this is the importance of campaigning. And think about it like this, you know, it might not affect you now. It might not affect you now, but it might affect you in the future. And if your lack of action might lead to circumstances that you're not happy with, say 10 years down the line. And I think it's about thinking about what's in the best interest of us as a community moving forward. And you might be that difference. You might be that difference. But if you don't get up and you don't actually take steps to try and challenge some of the stuff that's going on around you locally, nationally, globally, then change will not come about. So please, you know, you are the future and you are the difference. And I'm referring to the youth. Asku show amra campaign luya o final segment matisi. Ar apnara campaign khoto jati ase. Campaign do look amra climate change luya matisi. Apnar domestic violence ase. Khoto jati campaign ase. Apnara involve hoka. Amra young bhai bunan gora asoin. আপনারা ইউনো ইনভলভ তুমি তাই নানি আরও তোমাতান এমপিজ লবিং খরো তুমি তাই নানি স্কুলের গিয়ে মাতো তোমাতান কমিউনিটির লগে মাতো তোমার নেইবার আইনত লগে মাতো কিতা করা যাইব যে আমরা নানি একটারে জাতি প্রবলেম হয় যদি আমরা কমিউনিটির মাঝে একটারে খিলা আমরা নানি সাহায্য করতাম ঠিক করতাম অ্যান্ড ইউনো ইফ ইউ ওয়ান্ট এবল টু কল ইন অর ইউ ওয়ান্ট টু নো মোর ইনফরমেশন অ্যাবাউট সাম অফ দ্য স্টাফ উইভ কভার্ড প্লিজ ডু ইমেইল আস অন দি ইমেইল দ্যাটস অন দ্য স্ক্রিন অর কল আস অ্যান্ড হোয়াট উই উইল ডু ইজ উই উইল ট্রাই অ্যান্ড গেট ব্যাক টু ইউ বাট থ্যাংক ইউ ফর ওয়াচিং অ্যান্ড We hope that you've benefited. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.